feeling mighty fine this morning? Well, you young folk, that's the name of that song that she was playing there. If you would please stand with me as we read scripture from God's holy word this morning, Psalm 34, verses 15 through 22. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. A righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all his bones. Not one of them will be broken. He will slay the wicked. The foes of the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems his servants. No one will be condemned who takes refuge in him. Our precious, most loving Heavenly Father, as we gather together this morning around the foot of the cross, Lord, we lay those burdens there for you to take from our hands. Lord, we lift you up and praise you and thank you for your love, your mercy, and grace. The touch of your hand that we feel on our hearts each and every day. God, we ask your hand be upon this worship time, that you be with each song that is sung. Be with the speaker of the hour, stand in his shoes, speak through his voice. May your message and your word be proclaimed. And for those who are here this morning for special reason to hear a special word, Lord, touch their heart. Lead them the path you want them to take. And we'll praise you for it all in Jesus' loving name. Amen.
Amen. You all are looking mighty fine this morning. You are looking mighty fine. Join us as we sing this morning our first song, I'll Fly Away.
Some glad morning when this life is over. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah! Christ is risen. Bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah! Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful?
Father, we thank you and praise you this morning that we can raise a hallelujah to your blessed, precious, marvelous, wonderful, and holy name, because you are God and you are good and your love endures through every trial, every tribulation, through every problem, every storm in our life. You are our God, and we praise you and we thank you. We especially thank you that you sent the King of Kings and Lord of Lords as a man to die for our sins and give us salvation in your grace and in your peace. And Lord, we pray for that one that's here today. Draw them by your Holy Spirit to come to the altar. Come to the altar. Forgiveness, forgiveness is in your hands to give. And we praise you for that. Let them draw nigh unto you, that you may be drawn closer to them. Bless Brother Christian as he comes to preach your word. Anoint him with your Holy Spirit power and with your word to go forth in strength. And we'll praise you for it now and forever. In Jesus' name.
Amen. You may be seated. Welcome to First Baptist Church, Russell Springs. It's good to see everyone this morning. If you're a guest, thank you for joining and worshiping with us. If you're watching on YouTube or Facebook, it's good to have you with us as well. We're continuing in Exodus. In the past two Sundays, we have spent all of our time at the burning bush. And so we are finally out from the burning bush where Moses heard from God, where he heard the name of God and heard what God was calling him to do. And we're now making our way back to Egypt. And after 40 years, Moses comes out of the wilderness and is on his way back to Egypt to do what God has called him to do. So this morning, we're going to be in Exodus chapter 5. If you want to go ahead and turn your Bibles to Exodus chapter 5, we're going to start in chapter 4. We're going to go over four verses in chapter 4 to kind of bring us into chapter 5. Today's title of the message is Discouraging Days. Discouraging Days. I bet there's several of us this morning that you've had a discouraging time in your life. Maybe this week was very discouraging for you. Some of you, you've had the most discouraging time of your life this week. For some of us, we've had moments to where we're just down in the dumps, we're blue, we're just not feeling it. And maybe that's you this morning. I'll be honest with you guys, I've had an awful, terrible week. My beloved and precious, the team I love so much lost to a 15 seed, and I've been discouraged. You can ask Gabby, I've been discouraged all week long. Not only on top of that, if you look in our church's bracket, me and the youth pastor Johnny, we're in last place in the bracket. And so we've had a discouraging time. So this message is for me, but you guys can listen as well. So Exodus chapter 5, we're going to start in chapter 4 in verse 27. Here's what God's word says this morning. It says, "The Lord said to Aaron," Aaron is the brother of Moses, "go into the wilderness to meet Moses." And so he went, and he met him at the mountain of God, and he kissed him. And Moses told Aaron all the words of the Lord with which he had sent him to speak, and all the signs that he had commanded him to do. And then Moses and Aaron went and gathered together all the elders of the people of Israel. And Aaron spoke all the words that the Lord had spoken to Moses and did the signs in the sight of all the people. And the people believed. And when they heard that God had visited the people of Israel and that he had seen their affliction, they bowed their heads and they worshiped him. And so at the end of chapter 4, what we see is Moses and Aaron, because remember, God had to bring Aaron along because Moses didn't want to do what God had called him to do exactly. Moses and Aaron, they go into Egypt and they gather the elders, they gather the people around, and they tell them what God has told them, that he is going to deliver his people. But not only does he tell them that, but they show them the signs. Now, remember the sign we talked about specifically last week was the sign of the staff, and they threw the staff down, it would turn into a serpent, and then when he picked it back up, it would turn back into a staff. And so they go and they perform these signs, and when they do this, when they give this word that God is going to deliver the people of Israel, and when they show the signs, Scripture tells us that the people believed. But they not only believed, but this belief led them, as we see in verse 31, it led them to worship. And so after a moment of slavery and complete misery for the Israelites, we now see there is a moment that they have hope. And because of this hope, they erupt in worship. They praise God. God, thank you so much. God, we love you. Exactly what we've done today. They raise a hallelujah up to God. Why? Because he's going to deliver his people. And so we can just imagine. We can imagine the Israelites in this moment. They're overjoyed. Why? Because God has heard their cries. They're hopeful of what's to come. They're relieved from the pain and the hard work that they've been under Pharaoh's hand for several years. And then we get to chapter 5. And in chapter 5, verse 1, it says this. It says, afterward, Moses and Aaron, they went and said to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast to me in the wilderness. But Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, and moreover, I will not let Israel go. And so the famous, as we've heard, the famous phrase throughout the story that we've heard as kids, Moses and Aaron, they go up to Pharaoh and say, let my people go. They're speaking on behalf of God. And Pharaoh's response is interesting. I'm not sure if this is sarcastic or if he's just being completely honest with them in this moment, but he looks at them and he says, guys, I don't know the Lord. Like, who even is this Lord? And in fact, guess what? I don't even care who he is. I'm not going to let the people go. And so Pharaoh, he did not know the God of the Hebrews. He did not know the God of Moses and the God of Aaron. And so because of this, he said, look, in my eyes, and this was in the eyes of Pharaoh, as probably the most powerful man in the world at this time, he was probably a god to himself. And so why would he follow someone who said their God had come up and told him to let the people go? Pharaoh had all the power. He's not going to listen to these guys. And so he does not let them go. And then look in verse 6. Verse 6, it says, the same day, Pharaoh, after they had went and asked him to let the people go, Pharaoh commanded the taskmasters of the people and their foremen, you shall no longer give the people straw to make bricks, as in the past. Let them go and gather straw for themselves. For the number of bricks that they made in the past, you shall impose on them. You shall by no means reduce it, for they are idle. Therefore they cry, let us go and offer sacrifice to our God. And then it says, let heavier work be laid on the men, that they may labor at it and pay no regard to lying words. Verse 10. So the taskmasters and the foremen of the people, they went out and said to the people, thus says Pharaoh, I will not give you straw. Go and get your straw yourselves wherever you can find it, but your work will not be reduced in the least. And so the people were scattered throughout all the land of Egypt to gather stubble for straw. The taskmasters were urgent, saying, complete your work, your daily task each day, as when there was straw. And the foremen of the people of Israel, whom Pharaoh's taskmasters had set over them, were beaten and were asked, why have you not done all of your tasks of making bricks today and yesterday as in the past? And so not only what we see here is not only did Pharaoh not care about the Israelites' God, but once they come and ask to be let go for a certain amount of time, he says, you know what? I'm just going to make their work harder. And so out of the evil that was within Pharaoh's heart, he makes what was already very, very difficult work in very extreme temperatures. People believe that, I mean, you're thinking they're working in 100-degree temperatures, and they're having to deal with things like heat exhaustion and dehydration. And so not only was the work already hard, but now they've made it what seems like 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, 5 times harder than it already was. And this was because of the evil that was within Pharaoh's heart. And so think about the Israelites. For the Israelites, let's be honest, this was a real slap in the face. I mean, they had just been told and had just been given so much hope. I mean, they had just given the hope that God is finally going to deliver them from slavery. And then all of a sudden, as Moses and Aaron go to tell Pharaoh to let them go, what happens? He just makes their work harder. And so what we see is they go from a moment of worshiping to everything gets worse. They go from worship to worse. Like, they're praising God, and then all of a sudden their life gets probably as worse as it has ever been. Has this ever been you before? Have you ever been in a moment in your life where you're just in a good season. You're in a season of praise and worship, and God is blessing you, and he's blessing your family, and you're serving in the church, and everything's going good, and then all of a sudden it just gets worse. And that worse gets worse. And that worse gets worse. Maybe you're in a moment where everything's going great, and then all of a sudden, an unexpected illness. Or maybe an unexpected death in the family. Maybe you've been in a moment where you've been serving in the church and you've been praising God, and then all of a sudden you get a devastating diagnosis. Or maybe you get the news you've been laid off of your job. Maybe you have been praising God and you've been reading the scriptures and you've been giving your time to Him in the morning and at night, and you feel like you're doing all you can, and then all of a sudden you fall back into those same old temptations that you used to several years ago. Or maybe you've been having good weeks. You found yourself in the house of the Lord surrounded by believers, but then all of a sudden you end up having one of the worst weeks of your life. Or maybe a terrible week at work, or maybe a terrible week at school. And once everything's going good, I believe all of us have had a moment when everything's going good and all of a sudden it all goes to worse. And this is the moment that the Israelites are in. But let's go forward to verse 20. Look at chapter 5, verse 20. It says this. It says, they met Moses and Aaron. These are the Israelites. And so once they find out their work has gotten harder, verse 20 says, they go and they meet Moses and Aaron, who were waiting for them. And as they came out from Pharaoh, they said to them, the Lord, this is what the Israelites say to Moses and Aaron, the Lord look on you, and may He judge you, because you have made us stink in the sight of Pharaoh and his servants. And you have put a sword in their hand to kill us. And so the people, they get upset with Moses and Aaron, as you can imagine. Moses and Aaron come bringing what seems like good news, and then all of a sudden they get a slap in the face. Their life gets as bad as it's ever been, and so they blame it on Moses and Aaron. They're upset with them. And you know what happens? This disheartens Moses. As you can imagine, any leader, if you've ever had a team member come to you and say something negative, this discourages a leader. And for Moses, he is disheartened in this moment. I mean, he had just gone from being in the presence of God. He saw God in the burning bush. He got to hear from His name. He got to speak with God directly. He got to see the signs and perform those signs that God had given them. And then all of a sudden this happens. And so what does Moses do? Look at verse 23. Verse 22. Moses turned to the Lord and he said, oh Lord, why have you done evil to this people? Why did you ever send me? And to Moses, man, this just seems like a terrible practical joke. Like God is just some evil prankster. He says, God, why could you do evil to these people? It just seems like a terrible practical joke. Almost like, have you seen those? I was watching on YouTube this week, and I saw one of those practical jokes where they give their family a lottery ticket at Christmas. Have y'all seen those videos? And they give them a lottery ticket, and they scratch it off, and they're like, all right, you're not going to believe this. And they're sitting in the living room, and they're scratching off, and then all of a sudden, they say they won $25,000 or $1 million or whatever it might be, and they're running around the living room dancing, and the whole family's laughing, and all of a sudden, they look on the back of the card, and it says it's fake. Like some terrible practical joke. They get their hopes up, and then all of a sudden, they tear them down, saying it's not real. This, for Moses, this is what this probably seems like. As if God has just pulled the chair for the Israelites to sit in, and as soon as they sit down, He pulls it out. And so what does Moses do? He accuses God of evil. He says, God, why have you done evil to this people? You promised deliverance, but now things have gotten much worse. And so the question arises, as Moses questions God about doing evil, is can God do evil, or is He doing evil here? We talked about this in our James series. In fact, it was several months ago. You probably don't remember. I believe it was in September. We were going through James chapter 1. And in James chapter 1, verse 13, it says this. It says, James writes, that God cannot be tempted by evil. Our God cannot be tempted by evil. And so for Moses to say that God has done evil, this is obviously a misconception of Moses' thought of who God is. Because in James, we learn this, that God cannot be tempted with evil. And because He cannot be tempted with evil, why is this? Well, we understand that our God is perfectly good. I mean, that's who God is. That's the definition of God, someone who's perfectly good. And God is perfectly good. And so because he is perfectly good, it is impossible for our God to sin. Why? Because his very nature and his very character is good. And that's who he is. And so for us today, we have the full scriptures. We have the Old Testament, the New Testament. We understand that our God does not do evil. We understand that he cannot be tempted to do evil. Why? Because in his nature, our God is perfectly good. But why does it appear to Moses in this moment that maybe God is playing some evil practical joke? Why does it appear to Moses that God is doing an evil? Well, here's the answer. The reason it appears to Moses that God is doing evil is simply this. Moses can't see the future. Moses, he cannot see into the future. And so because he cannot see into the future, this act right now, it seems that God is evil, that he is just some evil prankster like that kid. What's that kid's name off Toy Story? Y'all know who I'm talking about? Johnny, you know who I'm talking about? Sid. It seems like God is Sid, that he's just bullying and torturing his people. Is this who our God is? No, it's not. Our God is perfectly good, but Moses, he cannot see into the future. We were watching a movie, and we were all watching a movie together this week called The Adam Project, and it's a new movie that's out on Netflix. And in this movie, this man named Adam, he comes back from the future. He comes back to his past as a kid. And so during this movie, he comes in this super awesome spaceship, and he visits himself as a child. And I'm not going to ruin, because it's a new movie, I don't want to ruin the movie for you. But what happens is he has to fix a problem in the past. And so he comes to his younger self, who is in probably middle school or grade school. And he comes to younger Adam, and younger Adam is as scrawny as he can get. In fact, one of the first scenes in the movie of younger Adam is him in the school getting punched in the nose by a bully. And this is the common theme that goes throughout the whole movie, is that this little Adam who is scrawny, he gets picked on, he gets bullied, he talks a lot, so he gets in a lot of fights. The whole theme is him, he's discouraged. Why? Because he can't beat anyone up. He's discouraged because he's always getting picked on. He's discouraged because he's always getting punched in the nose by bullies. And so throughout this movie, this discourages Adam. This discourages little Adam. But you know what happens? Adam sees his future self. His future self comes in on a spaceship. He comes into his house. He sees his future self. And his future self, if you watch a lot of movies, it's Ryan Reynolds. And Ryan Reynolds, he comes in. I mean, he's just jacked. And Adam sees himself. And he says, man, this is me? And he's like, yeah. He's like, dude, I'm buff. Like, I'm swole. And not only does he see that his older self is jacked, but he can put that muscle to work. He sees him. He goes outside, and I mean, I'll rip my pants, but you get the point. I mean, he's beating everybody up. I mean, this guy has got the moves. Little Adam, he couldn't beat up a fly, and all of a sudden he sees his older self, and he's putting the beat down on all these futuristic characters. And when he sees that, you know what little Adam sees? He sees a glimpse into what's to come. Little Adam, though it seems bad now for his life, he sees a glimpse into the future. And the problem with Moses, why he accuses God of evil, and the problem with us as sinful people, the problem when we accuse God of evil, the reason is you know what? We can't see into the future. We don't get the glimpse of the whole glorious plan of God. And Moses, he could not see what was to come. He could not see the bigger picture. And so for us as Christians, this is our issue. Is our issue is we think that now, whatever the present is, we think it equals forever. We think that now equals forever. Whatever pain, whatever trouble, whatever disencouragement, whatever issue, whatever season of life we're in, we think and feel that it means it will last forever because we tend to forget about God. We put God on the back burner. Or like Jonah, we deliberately throw him aside and go the opposite direction. You know what happens? We give up on God. And in Exodus chapter 5, we see that things get worse. It's really bad. I mean, these people are miserable. But you know what? I'm thankful for? I'm thankful for whoever numbered the rest of the chapters in Exodus, because you know what we see? Is there are more chapters to come. Chapter 5 looks bad. Chapter 5 looks terrible, but you know what happens? Chapter 6, God reassures his promise of deliverance. He doesn't free him yet, but we go on to chapter 6, and he reassures the promises of deliverance. You know what happens in chapter 7? God begins the plagues on the Egyptians because they're not listening to God to let the people go. Chapters 8, 9, 10, and 11, what happens? The plagues continue, and then we get to chapter 12, and I'm just going to read one verse from chapter 12 very quickly. In chapter 12, verse 31, it says this. It says, then, this is Pharaoh. Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron by night. And he said, up, go out from among my people, both you and the people of Israel, and go and serve the Lord as you have said. Take your flocks and your herds as you have said, and be gone. And so it seemed like a miserable, terrible moment where God had just played a practical joke on them. What they don't see is that 7 chapters later in our scripture, 7 chapters later, Pharaoh was going to let the people go. Why? Because of God's hand and God's providence that was over the Israelites. And sometimes, church, we get stuck in that chapter of discouragement. Sometimes we get stuck in this same chapter and we forget that there's more chapters ahead in the story. Aren't you glad, First Baptist, that there was more chapters in your life? I know I am. I'm so glad for a God who did not end in chapter 5 but kept my life going. And I've seen him work in every single chapter. I'm thankful for a God who has more chapters in our story. But some of us, we're just discouraged this morning. Some of us, if we had to title the chapter of our life this morning, we would just simply title it The Discouragement Days. We would title it The Discouragement Days. We're discouraged with how our life has turned out. We're discouraged with our own spiritual walk with Christ. We're discouraged with promotions we didn't receive. We're discouraged with sickness that we just can't seem to beat. We're discouraged with the feelings of inadequacy. We're discouraged by the constant evil that's going on in the world. Every time we turn on the news, we're discouraged by unanswered questions. Some of us, we're in a chapter right now of the discouragement day. And this is the chapter of our life. But what is discouragement? Did you know what the definition of discouragement is? Google writes it this way. You can trust Google. Google's definition is this. Discouragement means a loss of confidence or enthusiasm. And so when we think of spiritual discouragement, what is spiritual discouragement? Spiritual discouragement is this. It's a lack of confidence in the promises of God. Spiritual discouragement is a lack of confidence in his word. Spiritual discouragement is a lack of confidence in the power of God. It's a lack of confidence in the love that God has for us, and it is a lack of confidence in God himself. This is what spiritual discouragement is. God, I'm discouraged because, God, I'm just discouraged because I just don't know if you can pull this one off. God, I'm discouraged because I just don't know if you're going to intervene in my life in this way. What is that? It's a lack of confidence in God himself. But this morning, we're here so that we don't let discouragement get us down. We're here this morning so that we can be encouraged by God's word. Now, here's what we could have done. And we're going to finish and wrap up very shortly. I could have titled this message, Dealing with Discouragement. And I could have looked in the scriptures, and I could have come up with 10 ways for you to deal with discouragement. We could have done that. You know what? We might do that one day. That seems like a great message. I'll write that one down. We might have a day where we just come in and look at 10 practical ways on how to deal with discouragement, because I know discouragement is something we all deal with for now until the day that we die. That's something that we could have done, but I don't want to do that this morning. What I want to do is go ahead and grab your Bibles and turn to John chapter 13. I'm not going to look at any practical ways for you to deal with discouragement this week, but here's what I want to do is you turn to John chapter 13. Man, I just want to give you encouragement from Jesus Christ himself, because I believe the encouragement for Jesus is going to be enough for everybody this morning. So look at John chapter 13. And this is where we're going to finish in John chapter 13, and then we're going to go on to chapter 14. John chapter 13 and 14. This is hours before the death of Jesus. And so hours before he's getting ready to die, these are some of the events that are taking place. Look at chapter 13, verse 33. We're going to skip around a little bit. But verse 33, Jesus says this, "Little children, yet a little while, I am with you. You will seek me, and just as I said to the Jews, so now I also say to you, where I am going, you cannot come." Go down to verse 36. And Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, where are you going?" And Jesus answered Simon Peter, and he said, "Where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow me afterward." And Peter said to him, "Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for you." And Jesus answered, "Will you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, the rooster will not crow till you have denied me three times." And so let's put ourselves in the perspective of the disciples. The disciples have given up everything. Jobs, social status, money, I mean, the thoughts of their own future that they had in their minds, they have given up everything to follow this man named Jesus. They've been ridiculed, they've been mocked, they've gone through slight persecution, and now they're at this moment, and what is Jesus doing? Jesus says, even though you've been with me, and you've learned from me, and you've seen my miracles, and you've followed me every step of the way until now, this is what Jesus says. He says, "Look, guys, I'm going to leave you. I'm going to leave you." And so the disciples, they're in this moment of discouragement. I mean, can you imagine leaving everything to follow this man named Jesus? You've left it all. You've been mocked. You've been made fun of. You've probably been called dumb because you followed this rabbi who says he's the Son of God. And they go and they leave everything to follow him. And then all of a sudden, after 3 years of ministry, he says, "Hey, guys, I forgot to tell you, but I'm leaving. And you can't go with me right now." Can you imagine the discouragement that's going through their head? I mean, you see Peter, and he speaks up on behalf of the disciples. God, you can't leave us. We'll go with you anywhere. And Jesus is like, "No, not yet. You can't go with me yet." And I just imagine in the life of the disciples, someone who has given up everything to follow Jesus, all of a sudden it's like he's ditching them, like he's played some kind of evil practical joke on them, led them all this way to think that he was the Son of God, and now telling them, "Guess what? I'm just going to leave you hanging, and I'm going to bounce." And so this is what's going through the disciples' heads. But let's look at chapter 14. And I want to do something different to close this morning. As I read chapter 14, I told you I'm not giving you any like practical steps to deal with discouragement. I just want us to hear from the words of Christ. And so now that we know, we see what's going on in the head of the disciples, we understand that they are in a deep moment of discouragement. So here's what I want you to do. I want everybody to take your Bibles. If you got your Bible with you or your phone, I want you to close it, all right? I want you to close your Bibles, you got your phone, you're reading it on your phone, I want you to lock your phone. And here's what I want you to do. As I read chapter 14, in chapter 14, Jesus gives what I would say his encouragement to the disciples in this time. These are the words of Jesus. If your Bibles still have the red words, these are the red words from Christ. And so in this moment, here's what I want to do. I want all eyes closed. With all eyes closed, I just want you to picture yourself. Maybe right now, you're in a discouraging season. I want you to think about that discouraging season. I want you to think about what's discouraging you in life right now with eyes closed, no one looking. Just you have a moment with God. What's discouraging you right now? And as you think about that, I want you to picture yourself. We're going to do a little exercise. I want you to picture yourself with Jesus. God himself in the flesh. I want you to picture you sitting down with Jesus in your living room, maybe in your bedroom. Maybe he's just sitting in the passenger seat in the car with you, and he understands your discouragement. And as you think about being with Jesus, I'm going to read the words from him. And as you hear these words from John chapter 14, don't listen to the words of Christian or the voice of Christian. I want you to picture you're listening to the voice of Jesus and how he would respond to you in a moment of your most discouraged season, okay? Let's listen to this. You're with Jesus right now. He understands your discouragement. And then in chapter 14, here's what Jesus would say to you. Let not your hearts be troubled. Let not your hearts be troubled, keeping your eyes closed, man, does that relieve something from your life? Does that relieve any anxiety from your life right now? To hear from the words of Christ, let not your hearts be troubled. But then he says this, believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. And so with eyes closed this morning, understand that do not let your heart be troubled. No matter how discouraged you are this morning, church, do not let your heart be troubled. Christ is with you, and guess what? He has gone to prepare a place for you. And one day, though we can't go now, one day we're going to get to be with Jesus in that place when he comes back. This is the most encouraging thing that I can know as a Christian, because you know what? In this chapter, I might be discouraged, but as a Christian who believes in Jesus Christ, in the chapter that is to come, where I go to a mansion with rooms that are prepared for me, I'm going to get to be with Jesus forever. Father God, we love you. And God, I ask in this moment as we finish our service, Lord, help us to be encouraged by your word. God, help us to be encouraged by the words of Jesus. And Lord, I just pray for anybody right now, God, who's going through a discouraging season, a discouraging moment, God, that they would hear the words of Christ. God, that they would hear those words and they would cling to those words and understand the chapters that are to come as a believer. God, the joy that we get to be with Jesus forever should encourage us until the day we die, no matter how hard life gets. And so this morning, Lord, I just ask a special request, God, and I cry out to you. Encourage the believers. And if there's anyone here who has not put their trust in Jesus Christ, God, if there's someone here in this sanctuary this morning or watching online that has not given their life to Christ, God, I pray that they would pray this prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins and rose again from the grave. And then, God, I pray that they would pray this last thing. Jesus, would you save me? And Lord, as they pray that, would you save them this morning? We know that when we call upon you, God, you answer. And so save somebody this morning. God, give them the courage to come down front and to share with me the good news of what has happened in their life. And we ask that this morning. In Jesus' awesome and precious name, everybody said, amen.
Let's all stand.
Come this morning as we sing.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided.
Be seated. Once again, thank you guys so much for coming. And man, if you're in a discouraging season, if you ever need anything, me and Brother Jared and Brother Johnny and Danielle as well, we're here for you guys. If you need anything, come by the church, give us a call, shoot us a text. We're here for you guys as well. So I love you. Tell somebody about Jesus this week, and Jared's got the announcements.
All right, just a few announcements before we dismiss. First, we lost a dear member of our church family this week. Miss Terry Lane Selby passed away, and her her services are today at Bernard's Funeral Home. Visitation for her is from 11 until 2 o'clock, and then the funeral services will be at 2. I'd encourage you, if you can, be there to support them, and if not, to definitely be in prayer for that family as they mourn that loss. Just a dear, sweet lady here at the church. Also, this Tuesday, we have our men's leadership luncheon at 12 o'clock. And so I'd invite all of the men to come, and we'll have lunch together, hear from a speaker about their walk with Christ and how that has worked in their life. Also, our Easter shirts are still on sale at the Next Step Pub in the Welcome Center. So if you haven't had a chance to get a shirt for Easter, I'd encourage you to do that. You can do that today in the Next Step Hub. Somebody will be out there to help you. And then lastly, next Sunday is a special day for us here at First Baptist. And we're excited about this day. It's a day that we're going to dedicate to our Celebrate Recovery program here at Russell Springs First Baptist. We've got a special guest that are going to come. The worship team from Celebrate Recovery is going to be here leading in worship. Excited about that. We have several baptisms from that program. If you don't know about Celebrate Recovery and the amazing work that's happening through that program, come and witness that, as we have seen many people come to know Jesus Christ through that, and we'll be able to baptize some this coming Sunday. It's going to be a good day. Invite someone to come with you. We'll have a full house this Sunday, and excited about that. All right. There's nothing else. If you would bow with me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you. For Father, you are good. Father, as Christian said, we don't get to see tomorrow, but we know that you're there, that you're there with us, that you're leading us. And Father, whatever comes, that we have you on our side. And Father, I pray, giving you thanks for that. I pray, giving you thanks for this church and the work of this church. Father, I ask that as we leave to go out into the world today, as we go out into a lost world that desperately needs your Son Jesus, Father, I pray that we would take the love of Christ with us, that we would go out into this world and share the good news of your Son Jesus, that they too may be saved.